My topic for the today evening is anesthesia for coronary artery bypass grafting, that is commonly called CABG, which can be done with or without cardiopulmonary bypass. I just wanted to highlight these words bypass, because here you can see the word bypass has occurred twice. In the initial line, coronary artery bypass grafting, that means we are bypassing the diseased coronary artery, that is the surgical process. Whereas the, in the fourth line, where you can see cardiopulmonary bypass CPB, that is a mechanical device where we will bypass the cardiac and the lung functions using an artificial machine called cardiopulmonary bypass machine. So this is just for clarification of youngsters, not for the seniors, sir. Now, before I can go ahead with my topic, I just wanted to show some of the angiographic views of the heart, which shows the coronaries, how the coronaries are spread on the heart. And this is the base of the understanding of coronary artery disease and the understanding of the coronary artery bypass grafting surgery, and how do we need to manage as an anesthesiologist. So this slide shows us the left anterior oblique angiographic view of the heart, where you can see precisely the right coronary artery. This is the right coronary artery, we can see very clearly. And this is the left anterior descending artery. And the branches of left anterior descending artery are the diagonals. You can see these are the diagonals. This is the 30 degree left anterior oblique view, which is seen in the angiogram. And this is next slide, which shows 10 degree right anterior oblique angiographic view of the heart, which shows left main coronary artery. You can see here, this is the left main coronary artery, this is the right coronary artery, and this is the left anterior descending artery, which diagonal branches. And the one which is going laterally, branching from the left main coronary artery, this is the circumflex, left circumflex artery. So when you call coronary artery disease, usually it is mentioned in the form of coronary artery disease with a single vessel disease, a double vessel disease, or a triple vessel disease. Most commonly, we hear the word coronary artery disease with triple vessel disease, TVD. What are the three vessels? This is the left main coronary artery, which branches into left circumflex and left anterior descending. These two are called the first two main branches of the left main coronary. And the other one is the right coronary artery. So when you call triple vessel disease, it means three major vessel related distribution system is diseased. So this is the rough idea of the coronary artery disease and the coronaries. And this slide got stuck here. I'm going to the next slide. Going forward. Can it be controlled to the next slide from the other end? Yeah, this is another view of the angiographic view. This is called left anterior oblique view. Here you can clearly see the left anterior descending artery, which is diagonals. When you say diagonals, it is cutting the heart diagonally, and these are the branches of left anterior descending artery. This is the left first diagonal, and this is the second diagonal. You can see the left circumflex artery. And the branch of the left circumflex artery, this is what is called obtuse marginal. Why it is called obtuse? Because the angle with which it forms from the circumflex is the obtuse angle. The obtuse marginals and the diagonals. Next slide, please. Yeah. So this is a simple ECG strip just to inform the postgraduates, a normal resting ECG with QRS complex. And this is how ST depression looks when there is in exercise, if there is a change in the supply demand ratio to the myocardium, you can see the ST depression clearly here. So in the lower side of the strip, you can see this is how a normal ST elevation looks, and this is how a normal ST depression looks. Next slide, please. Yeah. So this is a correlation between the various areas of the heart, which is being supplied by, as I already told, the three major vessels, left anterior descending, left circumflex, and the right coronary artery. And based on the ECG changes and in a given lead, we can identify which area is ischemic and which coronary artery is diseased. Here you can see this is the lateral side of the lateral wall of the heart or the left ventricle. They are darkly shaded here, and this is being supplied by the branches of left circumflex. So if there is an ischemic zone in the lateral side of the heart, you can see the changes in the lateral leads. Here you can clearly see from here V5 and V6, you can see the ST elevations here. And at the same time, you can also see this clearly reflects that the lateral wall of the left ventricle of the heart is ischemic, and the area of interest or the area of the coronary which is involved is the left circumflex. Next slide. Yeah, this once again, the anatomical side here, you can see this is the posterior aspect of the heart. This is called the posterior wall. And this is, once again, you can see the red line here. This is the circumflex artery involved. And the posterior area, if it is ischemic because of the disease in the left circumflex, you can see ST and T changes here, like you can clearly see here in the V2 and V1. The ST changes are there. And this is the reflection of left circumflex disease in the posterior wall. Next slide. Once again, you can clearly see without looking at the upper picture, you can straight away see that there is a clear-cut ST elevation in lead 2, lead 3, and AVF. So these are the leads which look at the heart from the inferior surface of the heart. So this is the area of ischemia, which is dominantly supplied by the right coronary artery. So when there is a ECG change seen in the inferior wall, reflected in L2, L3, and AVF, we can say that the lesion is in the right coronary artery. Next. The same way, this is one important thing we have to look at it. This is the area of the interventricular septum. Practically speaking, interventricular, it is not interventricular septum, it is interventricular muscular mass. It is a very thick structure, which contributes a lot to the left ventricular ejection. So this area is supplied by these branches we call septal branches. This is the left anterior descending. These are the septal branches. So left anterior descending artery is the most important blood vessel, which supplies the major portion of the anterior, a bit of lateral apex, as well as the interventricular septum. So left anterior descending artery is the most important vessel, which contributes an important role in the ejection, or in other words, the cardiac output. So if you look at the ECG changes here, you can clearly see that V1 to V4, you can see the ST changes clearly. So this area reflects the anteroseptal area, and the culprit vessel is left anterior descending artery. Next slide. The same way with, as I already told, the left anterior descending artery supplies the major portion of the anterior portion of the left ventricle. So this is what we call anterior wall of the heart. So once again, any ischemic area, if it is an anterior portion which is involved, it is invariably, majority of the times, the left anterior descending artery is the culprit vessel. And you can see the ECG changes here, V1, V2, V3, V4. So anterior septal as well as the, sometimes you can clearly see the changes in the lead one. So the first step of the investigation and moving towards the coronary artery is any patient comes with a clinical doubt about the chest pain. And once the clinical symptoms and doubt about chest pain, he usually gets an ECG done. And once the ECG shows some changes, invariably the progress of investigation goes on and on. So to initiate a coronary angiogram, ECG is the baseline investigation based on which we will move forward to investigate the lesion involved. Next slide, please. Yeah. See, as I already told, coronary artery disease is not a disease which is limited to one vessel or two vessels. It can involve all the three vessels, or sometimes it can be single vessel, or sometimes it can be two of the major vessels. Here, if you can see, as I already told, see, there is an ST segment depression in V3, V4, V5, V6, whole of the lateral wall. You can see the ST changes. The same way, if you can look at lead one and lead two, and here, you have changes here, and at the same time AVF is also having ST depression. So it clearly says that it is not a disease involving one single segment, one single coronary artery. Lateral wall is involved, inferior wall is involved, anterior is involved. So this could be a typical coronary artery disease involving all the major blood vessels, that is a triple vessel disease. Next slide, please. Yeah. As you all of us are clearly aware that the coronary artery disease is nothing but tilting of this balance, what we are seeing. This is being taught for us from the childhood days, from physiology onwards. The oxygen supply and oxygen demand. The supply is dependent on the content of arterial blood and the coronary blood flow. And the demands, as you already know, that it is dependent on the contractility of the heart, afterload, preload, and the heart rate. If the oxygen supply is less, the balance is tilted. If the oxygen demand is more, once again, the balance is tilted. So coronary artery disease is nothing but an imbalance in this myocardial oxygen balance. Next. Right. This is actually before going to the pre-anesthetic examination. These are the various risk factors which is associated with coronary artery disease and the cases coming for coronary artery bypass grafting. So this is a old method of risk evaluation, cardiac operative risk evaluation. This is called European System for Cardiac Operative Risk Evaluation, Euroscore. This is the first version that was released in 1999. This involves a lot of patient management. And no one is interested to look at the patient status preoperatively. And once the patient goes out of the OT, most of the postgraduates presume that everything is well, all is well. So it is not so particularly in coronary artery disease. Next slide. Yeah, if you look at the preoperative management, just like in any other surgical procedure, we need to get lot of investigations, and investigations, as all of you know, the surgical profile, it starts from basic lab investigations, complete blood picture, random blood sugars, liver function tests, etc., etc. Apart from these lab investigations, I just wanted to speak on few investigations which are specific pertaining to the coronary artery disease and coronary artery bypass graft perioperative management. Routine lab investigations, as is done by any surgical profile. Apart from that, I already told our patient coming for coronary artery disease, revascularization, surgery to the OT, will go through the sequence of events, having some symptoms, thinking that it is a coronary artery disease or heart problem. They get an ECG done, and any changes in the ECG, automatically the cardiologist gets involved, and 2D echo is being done. So if you look in that sequence, investigations are already sequentially done and come to the cardiac OT. the ECG, echo, coronary angiogram. If there is a problem in echo, if there is a problem in ECG, as I already told, to identify the area of involvement, automatically it sequences to angiogram. And then once in angiogram, if they identify it as a lesion which needs to be revascularized surgically, the lesions which can be stented, they'll go ahead with stenting. And if the lesion is non-stentable, or if the lesions are multiple which needs surgical revascularization, then only the patient is sent to the cardiothoracic surgeon for surgical revascularization. And in the investigation part, as you know, chest x-ray, and these days routinely the high resolution chest tomograph, HRCT, it is being routinely done with the COVID in background. And if you say investigations, once again, we can also include RT-PCR for COVID-19. I think over a period of time, it becomes a routine. And then the other investigations which are associated with coronary artery disease coming for coronary artery bypass grafting is the peripheral vascular Doppler, which is very important for us. Because as I already told, these coronary artery disease patients, majority, almost 25 to 30% of the patients are associated with carotid artery disease or any peripheral vascular disease, iliofemoral or something beyond that, distal to that. So all these patients coming for coronary artery bypass grafting with coronary artery disease, these days, peripheral vascular Doppler is also being mandatorily done to rule out any other coexisting vascular lesions. Next slide. So in this preoperative thing, can you please go back to the slide? Back slide. Yeah. So pre-anesthetic examination, nothing more than what is being done regularly for any other surgery, except as I already told, we need to have a detailed information regarding the ECG, 2D echo, angiogram, chest x-ray, and routine coronary, routine surgical profile. And in the pre-anesthetic examination, if you can say, it is to be done completely, all systems need to be examined, starting from CNS, CVS, anyhow, it is already being thoroughly investigated, renal function, airway management, respiratory system, GIT, everything. So there is nothing specific which we can say more or less about pre-anesthetic examination. Pre-operative medications and pre-medication, these are the two things which I need to stress more, because majority of the patients coming from coronary artery disease invariably have coexisting medical illnesses like diabetes, hypertension, hypothyroidism, or any other lesion for which the patient is taking medication. So as till now, I could never come across a patient who comes for coronary artery bypass grafting who is not using any medications for any disease. That is for sure. And pre-medication, as you all know, it is a combination of angiolysis, amnesia, analgesia. Based on the patient's condition, you can choose whatever medications. Routinely, we use short-acting benzodiazepines. And regarding the pre-operative medications, in the subsequent slides, I will elaborate which drugs to be used, which drugs to be withdrawn, and which drugs need to be given special importance. Next slide. Coming to the intraoperative management, it has got in coronary artery bypass grafting procedure, invasive lines basically means we need to have an invasive arterial blood pressure monitoring, and we need to have a central venous line, whether in the form of regular triple or four lumen line, or along with it a pulmonary artery catheter, and the monitoring. All the regular monitorings what we have, we are using for any other surgery. Along with that, some add-ons to have a special reference, I will show in the next subsequent slides. anesthesia induction, anesthesia maintenance, analgesia, IV infusion drugs, fluid balance, and cardiopulmonary bypass. These are the various headings with which we need to discuss the intraoperative management. Next slide. The postoperative management, unlike majority of the non-cardiac surgical patients where the patient is fully conscious, coherent, and having orientation around about the surroundings, in the most of the cardiac surgical patients postoperatively, if it is extubated on table, well and good, at least to some extent, the patient can take care of his airway status. But a patient on ventilator with an endotracheal tube in place, transportation is one important thing we need to concentrate on to avoid any disasters. We need to maintain the endotracheal tube in place with proper ventilation continuing. We need to maintain the central venous lines, arterial lines. We need to see that all the drugs which are being connected intraoperatively needs to be transported along with the patient to the intensive care unit. So transportation of a CABG patient is as important as maintaining intraoperative monitoring. So I just wanted to show that as an important thing, particularly in managing coronary artery bypass, because many of the disasters are, we have experienced a lot of disasters during transportation. We need to continue the monitoring during transportation. We need to know what is the ECG status. We need to know what is the hemodynamics. We need to know patient whether is oxygenating well or not with the saturation and all. And we need to know whether the IC drees, that is the drains from which it is connected, are properly transported below the chest level or not. So all these things are very important in the patient transport. Monitoring, you all know pretty well. I will come to it in the next slides. Sedation, analgesia, ventilation are the things which are discussed in any other session. So I don't want to go in detail about all those things. Mediastinal pleural drains, these are the things which are very, very important pertaining to the transportation. Infusions and transfusions. Infusions, I already told, patient, majority of them are on various inotropic supports, sedative drugs, continuously flowing insulin infusions, all those things. So all those things come under the infusions along with the IV fluids. Transfusions, based on the requirement, patient will be on the whole blood transfusions or packed cells or fresh frozen plasma or the platelet transfusions, so on and so forth. All those things come under transfusions. And intra-aortic balloon pump is one thing where which gives a lot of, we need to be very careful during transportation of the patient from OT to the ward or the ICU setup. So these are all the things which we need to concentrate in the postoperative management. Next slide, please. Yeah, this, as I already told, these are the various medications, preoperative medications. Majority of the patients will be on most of these medications on. So in the pre-anesthetic examination, we need to guide the patient properly, and we need to clearly write in the pre-anesthetic checkup or pre-anesthetic sheet which drugs to be continued, which drugs to be reduced in doses, which drugs need to be withdrawn. So there is a clear-cut guidelines for most of these drugs. To generalize, I can say the majority of the beta blockers, statins, and calcium channel blockers, most of the centers, they continue using it on the day of surgery also. The only one drug which most of the times we try to hold on the day of surgery is ACE inhibitors, angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitor, because of the risk of hypotension and the risk of vasoplegia syndrome. And it is seen in majority of the patients, if not all patients. You can come across vasoplegia syndrome, and we can come across severe hypotension in patients who were continuing the usage of ACE inhibitor. So ACE inhibitor is one drug which we try to withdraw on the day of surgery. And regarding the antiplatelet agents and regarding the aspirin and other anticoagulants, I explain you in detail in the next slides. So rest of the other oral hypoglycemic agents, as you practice in any other regular non-cardiac surgery, on the day of surgery, you try to hold oral anticoagulants because of the prolonged duration of action. We will control it by IV infusions of insulin. So, and coming to the antibiotic prophylaxis, we need to time it properly. We have to maintain a time gap of 30 to 60 minutes, within the 30 to 60 minutes. And majority of the centers, they prefer using first or second generation cephalosporins based on the body weight. If there is any contraindication of cephalosporins, we can use vancomycin as an alternative with 15 milligrams per kg body weight. Along with that, an aminoglycoside to cover up the gram negative. Next slide, please. So this is a small summary of preoperative orders. It is not extensive. Antibiotics, as I already told, cefazolin or cefuroxime, first or second generation cephalosporins based on the body weight. Vancomycin, if cephalosporins, you have some contraindication. And orders to stop specific preoperative medications. Preoperative medications which need to be specifically stopped in the consecutive slides, I'll explain. For example, when to stop the clopidogrel, when to stop the aspirin, all these things. The majority of these centers, they continue using Ecoscreen even on the day of surgery. And clopidogrel, 4 to 5 days, is being withdrawn before surgery. The next slides, I'll show in detail about all those things. And antiseptic scrub, chlorhexidine scrubbing, is done twice or thrice the day before surgery. And then we usually need to add mithrocin 2% nasal ointment. This is because most of the nasal carriers of Staphylococcus aureus, in one study, some 20 to 30% of the patients coming for coronary artery bypass surgery, they are found to be nasal carriers of Staphylococcus aureus. Mifepristone 2% nasal ointment applying thrice a day before and during coming before the surgery is helpful. Chlorhexidine mouthwash and skin preparation. Skin preparation, as you all know, nowadays the eraser technique is being abandoned and the epilation is being used majority of the centers. NPO status, that is same like any other procedure. Usually 6 to 8 hours is minimum required NPO status. And preoperative medications as per the anesthesia orders. Preoperative medications, I already showed in the previous slide, based on the patient's condition, we need to specifically order which drugs to be stopped and which drugs need to be continued. Next slide, please. Yeah, this is a slide showing the platelet inhibitors, when to be stopped before surgery. As you can see, aspirin, here it is given 3 to 7 days, but some centers, they use even the day before surgery. So coming to the clopidogrel, 5 to 7 days to be discontinued preoperatively. Likewise, the various drugs and the number of days and hours you need to discontinue is clearly given here. And there is no need for everyone to just keep everything in mind. You can just keep this as charts and you can refer it whenever possible and you can use it in your pre-anesthetic examination area. Next slide, please. Next slide. Yeah. Yeah, this is a slide showing intraoperative monitoring for myocardial revascularization. As I already told, basic requirements for coronary revascularization surgery, ECG, arterial blood pressure monitoring continuous, and pulmonary artery catheter. Pulmonary artery catheter, there is no evidence that there is an improved outcome by using PAC in all cases. Of course, these cases of salmonella aortic atherosclerosis, nowadays people are using only in situations of severe elevated infection and with pulmonary hypertension and all. But if there is a associated TE monitoring, pulmonary artery catheter is slowly being waded off. TE, nowadays TE is recommended for all cardiac operations. This is the recommendation. This was the recommendation which was not there maybe a half a decade ago or a decade ago. Now it is clearly indicated that the transesophageal echocardiography is a monitoring device. It is promoted as a monitoring device for all cardiac operations. A decade ago, TE was specifically used for valve repairs and any specific indications. Now, this has become a mainline monitoring tool in cardiac OT. Neurophysiological monitor, cerebral oximetry, if it is available well and good, it detects the catastrophic events. It helps us in regional variation in the oxygenation status of the brain. But there are, we need to get more feedback from the prospective studies. Temperature monitoring and Foley's catheter, urine output monitor. These are the basic minimum monitorings which is required for coronary artery bypass grafting. A word on ECG. In ECG also, in the monitoring, we try to keep V5 lead and L2 lead. Why? Because V5 is most sensitive for myocardial ischemia. And lead 2, where we can detect rhythm disturbances and inferior wall ischemia precisely. So majority of the monitors, mandatorily, they will show us V5 and lead 2. These two leads are very important in coronary artery disease, at least, for monitoring the inferior wall ischemia and for monitoring the rhythm disturbances. Next slide. So when you look at the induction and maintenance, there is nothing like no single inducing agent or the no single maintenance drug which is universally accepted for A to Z type of cases. We need to have a broader perspective of what are all the anesthetic agents available, what are all the drugs which need to be used for a given, tailored to a given patient. The idea behind the anesthetic induction is we need to have a tight control of the hemodynamic parameter. We should avoid tachycardia, we should avoid hypotension. Both of them are detrimental for ischemic heart disease. Any tachycardia, any hypotension, they aggravate the existing, pre-existing ischemic heart disease and they tilt the oxygen balance to the myocardium. So this is very, very important. Particularly, as I told, the left main and proximal LAD disease patients, we have to avoid tachycardia and hypotension. And what drug to use, which drug causes less tachycardia, which drug causes more tachycardia, all these things are given in the basic anesthetic drugs pharmacology. Fast-track anesthetic protocols aiming for early extubation are favored for most patients. Given the increasing evidence of preconditioning effects, see, volatile anesthetics has an important role in cardiac anesthesia, particularly in coronary artery disease because of the added advantage of having preconditioning and post-conditioning effects. Commonly used are sevoflurane and isoflurane, regularly available inhalational agents. And we need to maintain coronary perfusion pressure without increasing the myocardial oxygen demand. That is what already I told. This is nothing but we have to maintain the myocardial oxygen balance. We should not increase the demand. We should not decrease the blood supply. That should be the aim of managing the balance. And antifibrinolytic therapy, epsilon aminocaproic acid and tranexamic acid are being used in the cardiac surgical armamentarium. The aprotinin was previously used, now it is being withdrawn. In OPCAP, it is not so relevant to have these medications. Consider low tidal volume mechanical ventilation and no PEEP during Lima dissection. Left internal mammary artery is used as a source of coronary perfusion in the left anterior descending artery disease. LAD disease, lima is being dissected. So because it is being dissected from the wall of the thoracic cage, the lungs will come in view during the dissection. So this is a statement which tells us to give the surgeon a space for the lima dissection while harvesting the lima anastomosing. Sometimes after anastomosis also we need to be doubly careful that the lung should not injure the left internal mammary artery graft. Next is heparin. Heparin usually is administered before clamping the left internal mammary artery pedicle to avoid thrombosis. And the dose is somewhere around 300 to 400 international units per kg body weight. So usually in patients with on pump, we maintain around 400, 450 above. And off pump cases, even 300 to 400 is adequate. Next slide, please. Yeah, this is the gist of all the anesthetic agents what we use in the cardiac surgery. This is a summary of hemodynamic effects of all the anesthetic agents. You can see that majority of the anesthetic drugs are having a net effect of reduced blood pressure. Majority of the drugs are myocardial depressants, which reduces the output, which causes vasodilatation, which in turn cause fall in the blood pressure. And if you look at the agents, specifically induction agents, anxiolytics, narcotics, and muscle relaxants, in the induction agents box, you can clearly see that etomidate is the only drug which has got minimal effects on the heart rate, contractility, systemic vascular resistance, and the net BP effect. So if given a choice in a cardiac surgical patient, particularly ischemic heart disease patient, you can say this is a suitable drug for induction. And the anxiolytics part, midazolam, propofol, and lorazepam. Most of the centers use midazolam or propofol, or midazolam and propofol both together. If you can see here the effect of propofol here, everything is falling. Heart rate is falling, contractility is falling, systemic vascular resistance is falling, and the net blood pressure is falling. So propofol means profound fall of all the parameters related to the heart. So we should be doubly careful when you are dealing with propofol induction in a patient where the hemodynamics are already compromised because of ischemic heart disease. And coming to the narcotics, fentanyl is the most widely used narcotic available as of now, which has got no effect on the contractility, but it has got a little effect on the heart rate and the systemic vascular resistance and the blood pressure. So fentanyl, alfentanyl, remifentanyl. Remifentanyl is ultra short acting. As of now, we never got an opportunity to use. But fentanyl is the most commonly used narcotic in cardiac anesthesia in the present day. And coming to the muscle relaxant, as you all know, pancuronium, icuronium, atricurium, sesadricurium, rocuronium, succinylcholine, these are all the drugs being widely used in all the other specialties. I don't want to go anything in detail about this, but only thing I can say is pancuronium is the only drug which has got vagalytic effect, which increases the heart rate. So whenever you are using high dose narcotic anesthesia, pancuronium is most commonly used combination along with the high dose narcotic anesthesia, which has got a negative effect on the heart rate, and vagalytic effect of pancuronium will counter the effect of the narcotics. So apart from that, vecuronium, if we can see, has got a neutral effect on heart rate, contractility, blood pressure, and systemic vascular resistance. If somebody has a drug of choice, if vecuronium is available, yes, we can use. But if you look at the cost difference, vecuronium is almost twice or thrice the cost of the pancuronium. So still, that is the reason why pancuronium, along with the narcotics, is the most widely used muscle relaxant in cardiac anesthesia. Next slide, please. This once again tells the various anesthetic drugs and their dosages and metabolism. Next. These are the various muscle relaxants used in cardiac anesthesia. Already I told, pancuronium, icuronium, sesadricuronium, rocuronium, pancuronium, is still the most popular drug in cardiac anesthesia. Sesatracurium. Yes, it has got a place when there is a associated renal dysfunction or hepatic dysfunction. Sesatracurium we can use as a relaxant of choice. And rocuronium, the intubating conditions are excellent with rocuronium, more so in this COVID season where first pass endotracheal intubation to be successful. Rocuronium is the choice drug these days. Next slide, please. A word about inhalation agents, already told. The ischemic preconditioning and the post-conditioning of the inhalation agent sevoflurane or isoflurane is the one plus point for its place in the cardiac anesthesia. And otherwise, the pharmacology, pharmacokinetics, pharmacodynamics, all of us, you are aware of it. Next slide. Next slide, please. Yeah, a word about thoracic epidural anesthesia. Coronary vasodilating effect of thoracic epidural anesthesia is well documented. There is no doubt about it. But the major concerns are the danger of devastating neurological injury, the potential for cancellation of a procedure in the event of bloody tap during epidural catheter, because cancellation of a coronary artery disease patient, if he is on unstable angina or if patient is having any ECG changes, if that particular patient has a bloody tap, it is a very big issue. So this is most important thing where the reason why it is not as popular as it used to be in cardiac surgery. And usage of potent antiplatelet drugs in patients with coronary artery disease. So that is one ubiquitous use. Insufficient data regarding when to safely discontinue those drugs before TEA and before catheter removal postoperatively. So these are all various concerns because of which neuroaxial block, particularly thoracic epidural anesthesia, is being used by few centers, and majority of the centers still are having their own concerns. Next slide, please. Yeah, so a small slide on, as I already told, once the patient is, we are aware of the hemodynamic effects of various anesthetic drugs, we are aware of the hemodynamic effects of various preoperative and intraoperative medications, what we are using. Now, we have already induced the patient, maintaining the patient, and the plan now is divided into two types. As I already told, coronary revascularization is being done based on the support of cardiopulmonary bypass, that is what we call CPB pump, or you can do without cardiopulmonary bypass, that is called off pump coronary artery bypass. So once the decision of going on pump or to operate or revascularize off pump is purely surgeon based and the lesion based and the intraoperative hemodynamics based. Based on the lesions involved, based on the size of the heart, based on the hemodynamics of the heart, based on the surgical expertise of the surgeon, the decision to go off pump or on pump is decided. But once patient is subjected for on pump bypass surgery, during before starting of bypass procedure, we need to go through a list of checklist sort of thing regarding the arterial inflow, venous inflow, whether the bypass is complete or not, heparinization is complete or not. All those things need to be checked before going on bypass. Next slide. Yeah, this is a simple summary of what we need to do as an anesthesiologist when the patient is on bypass. We need to support the perfusion pressures using vasopressor drugs. We need to give adjuvant drugs to optimize renal perfusion if required. We need to maintain the adequacy of the depth of anesthesia with inhalational agents. We need to monitor the cerebral oximetry status. We need to sequentially send ACT samples to maintain heparinization at the adequate levels, we need to send ABG from the pump to maintain the oxygenation status, electrolyte imbalance, acid-base imbalance need to be corrected, and we need to re-administer antibiotics on pump, whatever antibiotics being used at the time of induction need to be repeated on pump, and blood glucose levels need to be maintained using IV infusions of insulin, and it should be rigidly managed. So a patient on coronary, on cardiopulmonary bypass, the anesthesiologist has a very important role, even the patient is on bypass. Next slide, please. Yeah, this is a simple picture which shows the various cannulation sites and how is it cannulated. If you can see here, this is the venous cannula, which is going through the right atrium into the inferior vena cava. So this is a double opening cavo atrial venous cannula. The venous blood is being drained and it collects into the reservoir and gets oxygenated, and then it is being pumped back into the aorta. This is the arterial cannula, which is being fixed at the ascending aorta, and you can see here there is an aortic cross clamp proximal to the arterial cannula. So blood is collected from the venous end, pumped, following our traditional Indian way of saying thank you, namaste. Over to Dr. Ramakrishna Reddy, sir.
Thank you, sir. It's an excellent presentation. I'm just waiting for questions in the chat box. So, Deepra, sir, just unmute your or remove your headphones. Deepra, sir. I'm just waiting for the Pervatra, sir. Unmute and unmute.
Yes.
So, Deepra, sir, just unmute. You are.
Yes, sir.
We are just waiting for the questions, sir. In the meanwhile, you can add some things, you know, like Deepra, sir. Any good point?
Like we have been out of this cardiothoracic for quite some time now.
Unmute.
It was quite a refreshing thing.
Yes.
Dr.
So,
Vijay Mohan.
Deepra, sir, just waiting for the questions.
Areas you have covered
very well. Meanwhile, you can add some things.
Long back when I was at Usmani as an assistant, I used to do a lot of cardiothoracic. Just waiting for the questions. Quite some time now. That quite a refreshing thing.
Yes.
Dr. Vijay Mohan, it was like going through again a textbook.
Just waiting for the questions.
Areas you have covered very well.
You can add some.
Long back when I was at Usmani as an assistant.
You can do the meeting, but overall, the quality of the audio
quite a refreshing thing.
Thank you.
It was like going through again a textbook. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Wish you a happy new year in advance, sir.
Thank you. Same to you, sir.
Thank you. All the same. Same to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Wish you a happy new year in advance, sir.
Thank you. Same to you, sir.
Thank you. All the same. Same to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Wish you a happy new year in advance, sir.
Thank you. Same to you, sir.
Thank you. All the same. Same to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Wish you a happy new year in advance, sir.
Thank you. Same to you, sir.
Thank you.